Assalamu alaikum, greetings and peace. How are you guys doing? We're in London, and look who I found. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How are you? Dr. Steph Keres.
That's correct, yes.
And you're from the background, he accepted Islam 20 years ago. You accepted Islam,
correct.
Right?
That's correct.
And guess what? He's from a Greek background. And some people out there are like, oh, he became a Turk? What do you have to say to that?
You know, in the Balkans, like this, people identify the religion, they put you actually together with the nationality. So as soon as you become Muslim, you become a Turk. But that's a very important point. We need to realize that when you become a Muslim, you become a Muslim. You don't change nationality, but you change religion, or actually way of life. Let's call it that way, because Islam is actually a deen. It's a way of life, guys. It's not just a religion. You know, there's much more to it. And everybody who's practicing Islam understands what I'm saying, what I want to say with that. Basically, nationality stays the same. I will die Greek, inshallah. So that's also for my parents, that they know that I will die Greek. So I didn't change nationality. I still have the same skin color. I haven't changed that. So alhamdulillah, what changed is my way of life, which has become better, alhamdulillah. And I've become a more fulfilled person. Alhamdulillah, I got married. I have 7 children, alhamdulillah. So I'm quite happy with my way of life and this chosen way of life since 1992, which is... How is it, 27 years ago, isn't it?
Yeah, wow, this is amazing, because what's important now is we have so many people who are coming to the realization that there's a purpose in life.
Right.
I want to live it. You had to go through so many challenges, because now you're not just going to accept Islam for the fun of it. So you really put it to the test. Safe to say? I mean, 3 years you were investigating, 3 years?
Absolutely true, yeah. It took me 3 years to come to the point to say Shahada.
3 years?
I mean, you have to understand, again, as we said, from the region where I come from, we come from actually, yeah, both from the Balkan Peninsula, people identify themselves with, you know, religion and nationality is one thing, is the same thing for them. So we have to understand, changing religion means also changing nationality, according to them. But that did not happen. That's not my idea, of course, alhamdulillah. Yeah. We became Muslim. My family is Muslim, alhamdulillah. My wife, by the way, is also a revert, as we call it. She is from South America. So also for her, it was like accepting, for them down there, it's more being an Indian.
Yeah, so you don't become a Pakistani,
you don't become,
because you're Muslim, you're kind of Arab. Yeah. No, just the same way if you become a Muslim, you don't become a Turk. No, you just become someone who has submitted to, look at this, this is turn on the light bulb, turn on the brain. Muslim is one who submits to the will of the Creator, not the creation. That's what a Muslim is.
That's right.
You chose to do that after deep contemplation, research based on proof and evidence, and you're here on the Deen Show today. Alhamdulillah.
Jazakallah khair.
And actually now, you're a historian, so you really talk to us about that, because you have to, you know, there's a lot of these myths that are perpetuated. You got some truth in there, and you got it mixed in with half-truths and lies and all this bunch of hodgepodge and a big buffet.
Right.
And then it brought you to where you are today.
That's the point. Is, I mean, many people find Islam through the Adhan or through the Quran or through many, 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 many things. But what happened to me was I became a historian. Actually, I accepted Islam through history, and that made me a historian, that made me a Muslim, that made me a Muslim historian, mashallah. So, alhamdulillah, nowadays I can proudly say that Islam and history goes together for me. History brought me to Islam, and Islam brought me further, alhamdulillah. So 26 years later, I have realized that a lot of myths and a lot of lies were told to us at that time. I was going to a Greek school, Greek primary school, and the same lies and stories that were telling them that time, they're telling them even nowadays. But the difference is that many have woken up and many have seen that, yes, not all of these things they're telling us at school were true, and not all of these things they're telling us even nowadays are true and are to be believed. So please be careful, that's all I have to say. Please be careful what they're telling you at school. Look deeper into it. Find out what actually happened in history. As difficult as it might seem, in the end, Allah showed me the way, alhamdulillah. So I can just say that, alhamdulillah, I mean, the truth of history led me to Islam, to the truth of our life. And that's what's more important, actually, than history itself, you know. Mm-hmm. But that led me to the deen, alhamdulillah. Mm-hmm.
I interviewed a former NFL alumni, and he's also from the Greek background.
Okay.
And his name is Tim, and inshallah, this show also gets to him, where he comes from the Greek background. He's been hanging around with some Muslims, and he's really liking, I gifted him a Quran and some of the other literature, talking about the purpose of life and, you know, the miracles in Islam, prophecies, all of the authenticity of the Quran, list goes on, because we don't just blindly surrender in Islam. It's based on authentic facts. Evidence, facts, proofs. All right, so now he's actually been given about 6-7 months to live. He has some form of leukemia, and they pretty much written him off. And now he's been exposed to Muslims, but now he's also at this crucial point in his life. What advice, you coming from a Greek background, you can connect with him, but the pressure is now, he's gotten out, so did some programs with him, he's talking, you know, on behalf of all the good experiences that he's had with Muslims. But now death is approaching, and he's in a battle, like, okay, my Greek background, Christian, or Orthodox Christian, and now this is coming to him. What advice do you have for him?
Very simple. One of the most important thing, your Greekness, whatever you feel that you are Greek. You will stay Greek, you will die Greek. Whoever you are, whatever you believe is in the end, you will be Greek, you will die as a Greek. One important thing is you're going to stand in front of your Creator. The Creator is not going to ask you, were you a good Greek? You know, how did you live your life as a Greek? But the Creator is going to ask you, how did you worship me? How did you worship God? Do you believe in God? Who is God? What do you believe God is actually? Who do you believe brought God to you? Who was the messenger? So being Greek has nothing to do with finding the death angels later, who will be waiting for you on your bedside. So be careful of that. Really look at that. Your life is coming to an end. A new life is starting. And it can be happy or it can be very sad. You know, and being Greek has nothing to do. The end is very important. And hopefully, inshallah, look into the deen. Look into what your Creator told you to do. Forget if it's called Islam or Christianity or Orthodoxy or Catholicism. Look into who's the Creator. What did the Creator tell us to do? Look at the authentic sources and find out actually what an end, a good end would be for you. So that's my advice actually. Look into it and forget what people say. Forget everything that your surrounding is telling you. That is not going to help him. No surrounding, no Greekness, nothing is going to help you except one thing, believe in your Creator. Yeah. And you will see him, inshallah. You will, inshallah, meet him later.
Yeah. Do you speak Greek?
I speak Greek, yes.
Say something in Greek. How you doing?
Tikanis.
And how would someone respond to that? Tikanis said,
Kala.
Kala.
Yes.
Tikanis, Kala. So how do we test? If people want to know, how do I know you're Greek? Hey, this guy, maybe he's...
You're absolutely right. Maybe he's just fake. Okay. Okay, να σας πω ένα πράγμα. Κοιτάξτε τι λέει το Ισλάμ. Κοιτάξτε τι λένε τα βιβλία. Και μην βλέπετε τι κάνουν οι μουσουλμάνοι. Έτσι, προσοχή παιδιά, μην ακούτε τι σας λένε. Σας λένε παραμύθια, σας λένε μύθους, σας λένε ψέματα. Ώστε προσοχή.
So, okay, we did the authenticity test, all right? Tell us one more.
Did I pass it?
Tell us one more thing. Tell us one of the myths that was perpetuated in the schools growing up and what the reality was.
The Ottoman Empire. The Ottomans coming to Greece, as they say, the Turks, as they call them, coming and raping our women, taking our children away, making them all Janissaries. Now, the question that I had was, if they made all our young boys Janissaries, then how come we still have a Greek nation? How come we Greeks are still there, we still speak Greek, and we are still Greek, we are a Greek nation? Raping all our women, well, what happened to all of them? They still, after that, there was a Greek nation still, as there was a Serbian nation, as there was a Bosnian nation, and Albanian, and so on and so on. So again, they exaggerate. History is sometimes is nothing else but a bunch of lies, you know, put together. So we have to be careful. We have to be careful. Just look at it from a neutral perspective. Try to look at history from a different perspective, for a more neutral one, if you can. Otherwise, history is a very biased thing. You know, Churchill said, history is written by the winners, by the victors.
Churchill,
yes. Yeah, so basically, that's very true, isn't it?
You want to really make sure it's history, not, as we say, his history. Yeah, you had this tragic...
New Zealand, basically. There's many people who have this mindset. They believe that Islam is a problem for the West or for certain countries, that the Muslims come here to invade us. But again, what I'm trying to rectify is not only our past history, but also our very... our present, basically. Is this all true? Is this really like this, that Muslims are here to eradicate the Western culture and Western civilization? What is a Muslim, actually? Because, believe me, if you had asked him, or if you ask him, what does it mean, Islam? He wouldn't be able to tell you. I'm sure that he wouldn't be able to tell you what Islam is,
what
a Muslim is.
Terrorists would have no idea.
You know, they would not. He would just say they're terrorists, but he himself is a terrorist, basically. So education is very important. Education on the right path is very important. That's the most important thing. And don't lie to our children, don't lie to our youngsters, don't lie to them. I heard something crazy in Greece, 2012, a documentary came out. And there was a bunch of academics, Greek academics, who came together and made this documentary, an excellent documentary, the first time that I saw something like this on Greek TV. And they admitted that indeed all these decades we were lying to our children. They admitted this openly. And when they were asked why, is the system like this in Greece? Why do we have to lie to our youngsters? They said, listen to that, because we want our youngsters to love their country. And my question is, if you need to lie to your youngsters in order for them to love their country, then there's something wrong with the country, right? So yeah, wow. It's crazy, yes. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm. So yeah,
misunderstanding of history and of myths, again, as we just explained, the idea of myths and lies that have become the truth to him and to everybody who's following him, basically. So in the end, it is very important to get a clear education, a clear understanding of what it actually means, what history means, what the truth is in history, and what are lies, and we have to start distinguishing. That's the truth, that's the lie. And that can be very difficult for certain individuals, okay? But it all goes back to your mindset. How do you understand your surrounding? How do you understand people around you? And I mean, this individual obviously has a twisted mindset, and unfortunately, he's not the only one. There are many more who have a twisted mindset, yeah. And we have to try to correct them, try to find out.
Where can people?
I wrote a textbook. Well, actually, the last 2 to 3 years, I've been busy with gathering sources here, left and right and up and down, and in any kind of languages. And there's a textbook coming out, inshallah, in Ramadan in May. And this textbook is about Islam in Europe. How did Islam enter Europe? How has it become part of Europe, I call it, actually? And we're looking into the three routes. It means Al-Andalus, so Spain, Portugal, Italy, and so on, the Ottoman Empire, and the Tatars. So these are the three routes. As well as we're looking into the Vikings, it's proven that there was connections between the Vikings and the Muslims, especially in Al-Andalus. There have been Vikings who accepted Islam. The last issue is the English version will focus on the British Isles as well. You would not say that Britain and the British Isles in general have a history of Islam long, long, long before in the 1960s and 70s when many Pakistani guest workers came over here. So it is not necessarily something new for the British Isles, for example, not at all. This is the one textbook with regards to the English textbook. Yeah. The German textbook focuses also on the German-speaking countries, so Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. As amazing. The history is absolutely unbelievable.
Amazing. And this book is called?
The History of Islam in Europe.
Yeah,
it's a textbook. You will find it from Ramadan on Inshallah. From my whoever wants can contact me.
How can they contact you?
info@stephcarries.com. So my name, info@stephcarries.com. That's it.
And you got so many gems here from this program, so many things that you can benefit from. We cleared a lot of these misconceptions, misnotions. And go ahead and leave some of the takeaways that you are able to take away from this episode. If you're someone struggling also from ethnicity, a lot of the false propaganda is perpetuated against Muslims and Islam. We said put the name tags, really see what Islam means. Look at the meaning and the message behind it and know that the truth will always be resisted. Every time there's the truth, it's going to be fought. So go ahead, and if you like what we had to say, continue to tune in, read the book. And there was one interesting gentleman, a scholar, who is actually from Britain in the book that you talk about. What was his name that accepted Islam?
Yeah, Abdullah Quilliam William. He accepted Islam in the 19th century.
He's a well-known figure?
He is a well-known figure in the British.
Say his name again.
Abdullah Quilliam William.
Yeah.
He became the Sheikh al-Islam of the British Isles by the Ottoman Empire. And he was living in Victoria in England, and he established the first mosque ever in this country, in Britain.
In Britain.
And he was a white solicitor, you know, a white guy who accepted Islam, so not Pakistani, not from outside, not Asian, not African. And through him, actually, more than 100 people accepted Islam through him, if not even more. Right. I mean, that's amazing. That's an amazing life.
We covered a lot, so this is another gem that's in the book. If you like the idea of worshiping only one God, to know your purpose, why you're here, where you're going when you die, and is based on evidence and proof, read the Quran, connect with us, continue to tune in to The Dean Show. We'll see you next time. Until then, peace be with you. Assalamu alaikum.
واجعله ربي رضيا يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام اسمه يحيى لم نجعل له من قبل سميا قال رب أنى يكون لي غلام وكانت امرأتي وقد بلغت من الكبر عتيا قال كذلك قال ربك هو علي هين وقد خلقتك من قبل ولم تك شيئا وحنانا من لدنا وزكاة وكانت